Well, good morning, Johnathan Johannes. We are very, very pleased to have you here participating in this iteration of Men at the Mantle. And you know that this is the companion series to the widely successful Ladies Leadership series that where we highlighted some of the female leaders within the banking and financial services sector in the Caribbean. What we hope to do with you today is to spend a little bit of time trying to get to know you and some of the things, some of your core principles, some of your management style, you know, those types of things, so that, you know, you can pass on your insights to the next generation of leaders coming up within the organizations who may pick up on some snippet that you share or some detailed core principle that you manage by, and, you know, will help guide them to the next levels in their career. So this conversation is going to be very casual. You know, I may get you to reveal things that you don't think you even knew, you know. but, you know, given that we know each other fairly well, you know, I'll try my best not to ask questions that you may not want to answer. You know, I question like this, I will not answer. What is your favorite beverage to go with coconut water? I won't ask that one. I'll leave that one aside. but thank you anyway. So tell us about your journey and, you know, to where you are now and in your life and your career. And, you know, you can go back as far as you want to. You can give us a little family biography and, you know, that kind of stuff. And, you know, and then a little bit of your professional biography and, you know, kind of bring us up to where you are now.
Yeah, well, I always like to start off by telling people my age. I think that's something that people are surprised by, and it encourages the youth to let them know that, hey, you don't have to be a senior citizen to reach the top in the banking profession. So I'm 43 years old, born and raised in St. Lucia, did my schooling here at St. Mary's College, went off to the A-level college, and then finished off in Trinidad. Whilst I've put in a lot of hard work at school, I think sometimes we tend to trivialize the importance of luck and timing. So I've benefited a lot from luck and timing in that at the time that I graduated, I happened to stumble upon a newspaper ad for the Barclays Bank Business Leadership Program. And that ad was running throughout the Caribbean. I remember my family saying, what do you have to lose? Just give it a shot. And out of, I think, about 300 applicants, they chose five of us to join the Barclays Bank's leadership program. And that was the start of a journey that was just phenomenal. I mean, all five of us remain close friends today. Most of us have moved on from Barclays First Caribbean, but we had each other on that journey, which took us all over the Caribbean. In my case, I worked in Belize, had the fortune, the pleasure of and good fortune of working on the merger between Barclays and CIBC in Barbados, transitioned to Antigua. I think at the time when I moved to Anguilla, I might have been 22, 23. And at that time, I was the youngest country head for First Caribbean Barclays ever. So I got to spend some good times in Anguilla. Transitioned to St. Kitts, back to Antigua. Did a stint at head office in Barbados and then had enough, right? So there was only so much of banking that I could take on at the time.
Right.
it was a whirlwind of a career with Barclays First Caribbean, but the burnout set in after about 10, 11 years. Mm-hmm. And I decided to try my hand in retail. It was pretty close to what I did in banking, which was sales. And I transitioned to Unicoma, where I was their director of sales for the OECS region for about 5 years. And you know what? To be quite honest, I think that was the most enjoyable 5 years of my life. And it's not that I disliked banking, but the pace of retail is so different to the pace of banking that I was accustomed to. And the excitement of going in every day and making changes to win and seeing the results taking place before your eyes almost an hour after decisions were made, it was just phenomenal. Every day you could win and make a difference. 5 years on, the position of managing director for First National became available. And again, family and friends and loved ones were like, these opportunities don't come up too often. Mm-hmm. You at least have to give it a shot, which I did. And knock on wood, I'm here today, 4 years later. And a lot of what I enjoyed and loved about retail, that pace, that energy, that excitement, I think I've been able to transition and bring it into my role where we're not the largest bank, so we take advantage of the agility. And mm-hmm. we try to move at the pace of retail, at the pace of Amazon. It's hard to achieve in a bank where everything needs regulatory permission and board level approvals, mm-hmm. but at least we try to speed up the process and keep things exciting out here. It's been a hell of a ride thus far, and I'm looking forward to greater things in the future. I'm married, no kids, been married for about 14 years. Don't know how she puts up with me, but she's blessed. And I just enjoy what I do, and I enjoy living life. Yeah,
I think it shows. And you know, I will say about you and your wife what I say about so many you know, high performing male executives. You know, you in selecting your partner, what I would say is you're punching above your weight. Clearly.
That's right. Clearly. I must have tricked her.
So, you know, I had this question I'll leave that for where I have it scheduled. But I think that is a very interesting story. And, you know, you clearly have traveled and lived in a lot of places. And this explains a whole other bunch of stuff in the back of my mind that, you know, I'll just leave alone. But it explains so much. Anyway, so I think, you know, you were fortunate in that you were with, you ended up in a structure where you got training along the way from, you know, from Barclays as to how to get into banking and, you know, how to run branches and all the different aspects of it. But so that's the external influences that kind of helped guide you. But what are some of your internal guiding principles and success traits that have helped you to get to this level that you're at?
You know, I think my guiding principle is, always remember you're not the smartest person in the room. And, mm-hmm. and the day you think you're the smartest person in the room, you need to get better people in the room as well. So for me, it's about collaborating and tapping into the ideas of others and embracing your limitations. Too often we tend to think of limitations as things that we should be embarrassed by and tend to hide those. But I try to let people know up front when I'm out of my depth. Mm-hmm. And I think that enables persons to understand that it's okay for me to step up and show my competence because I'm part of this team. And if mm-hmm. my leader has said, hey, I'm out of my element on this one, it's my time to shine. So yeah, when you embrace those limitations and you give others the opportunity to shine, you build a stronger team around you. And that's what we need to propel business in the future. We don't need rock star leaders or superstar leaders. We need rock star teams. And I think by building solid teams, embracing your limitations, and surrounding yourself with persons who complement you and your skill set, I think that's what has enabled me to enjoy some success. And it will continue to be a guiding principle that I hold dear.
So, you know, I think what I find interesting, so I've done a couple of these interviews, and this is one of those, seems to be a uniform trait across the individuals with whom I've spoken, where, you know, they recognize that if you hire what I like to term subject matter experts within your organization, right, on your teams, then you have a much stronger team because everyone is excelling at what it is that they do, that then you are kind of, you know, the coordinating effect. And, you know, you have the grand vision and, you know, they can help you execute against that given their specific disciplines that they bring to the table. I really think that that's something that younger managers really need to pay attention to, because I think there is a natural tendency when you make the jump from the technician to the manager. To say, oh yeah, I know everything now. So I think that's a good point. I mean, I think that's a good point to raise.
And on the point you just raised about it being a common philosophy held by most of the people you've interviewed, it just speaks to what we see in the industry in the fight for talent. If everybody has that similar philosophy, then everybody's looking to surround themselves with the best and brightest. So the fight for talent in our sector is strong. It's an attractive sector, and young professionals should really look at it as a career path.
Yep, I would agree wholeheartedly. So, you know, speaking about that and speaking about young professionals, I know you and I both serve on the CAB board, and that's not a secret. And so you see the dearth of male applicants that we get when we,
yes,
when we go to market to try to get individuals to apply for our scholarships. These are scholarships that we're giving away free of charge to do both your undergraduate and a postgraduate in banking and or finance. And the dearth of male applicants is just remarkable. And so there's a lot has been said about the perceived advantages and or disadvantages that favor men rising to the top in the banking industry compared to their female colleagues. Does your experience either on your way up or what you're kind of seeing now around us, does that bear support to that view?
You know, I keep hearing similar comments being made. But to be quite honest, I don't feel it. I don't see it. Perhaps it's because I work in the best region in the world, the Caribbean, where St. Lucia is ranked number 3rd in the world when it comes to chances are your boss is a female. I think our chances were about 55%, if I remember the numbers right. Jamaica was right up there. So the Caribbean has really demonstrated to the world that women in leadership positions can be successful for companies and have been successful for companies, not just in companies, but leading countries as well. So I haven't seen it. This old boys network may have existed before I came up, but when I came up, it was merit-based. And I work with some fine ladies who have moved on to excel in the Barclays First Caribbean world. I've worked with great executives, male and female, at Unicoma, and gender has never come into the conversation. And even at First National, take one look at my annual report. I think we only have 3 guys on there out of a 10 exec team. So we are heavily driven by women right now, and I'm hoping that at a future date, if I ever transition, I'm hoping to be succeeded by one of my female execs. So So I don't see it as there are any favorite paths for males as opposed to females. Like I said earlier, our industry and our profession, we are trying to surround ourselves with the best and the brightest. And there's this fight for talent, and we'll take it no matter what the gender is.
No, I tend to agree with what you've said. And, you know, when you said that, you know, said something about the good old boy network, you know, I smiled because, you know, under no definition would you be able to get into that network. So, you know.
but there's one thing I would add, and it goes back to your opening, right? We look at all these scholarship opportunities that the CAB puts out there, and 9 out of 10 applicants are women.
Yep.
So you could expect to see the region moving in that direction where more women are in the C-suite, right?
Yep.
So I think it's a wonderful time to be a leader having to deal with this transition. And I think we work in the best region in the world when it comes to diversity, because no one really cares about gender. We care about merit and performance.
I think that is so, so true. And, you know, I think one of the things that I often say to individuals who ask me a similar question is, you know, look at, you know, the two large indigenous banks in Trinidad. One's led by a female, one's led by a male, you know. And so, you know, and I think you just kind of look around and you look at our board who is representative of the top executives from all across the region. And you see we have, a lot of female representation there as well. So, you know, obviously you've had quite the trajectory. And so that you're still at this young age, excelling and leading, you know, a financial institution in your home country. I think it's always good to do that, you know. And you know, we'll talk about your leadership of the consortium a little later on. But you know, what are you most proud about as a leader in the industry, and more broadly? What would you say has been your greatest impact on the people around you?
Wow.
I know, that's a deep one, isn't it?
Yeah. It's still a work in progress too, right? I think what will ultimately be my crowning achievement is fully integrating the assets of RBC, which we just acquired with First National Bank, and truly creating one bank, one team, where we have built something together that's better than what we even imagined. It takes First National from the St. Lucian shores over into St. Vincent, which is a bold step for a small bank. But I think that's what I'm most proud of, because we dreamt big, we took a moonshot, and we pulled it off. And it's not just we as in First Caribbean, in First National, it's about the indigenous banks that were part of the journey and part of the process. I think we sent a signal to the region that there's more to be gained through collaboration than competition. And if people dream big and trust each other, great things can be accomplished, not just for companies and banks, but even for governments and the region in general. During this process, I honestly felt like I was part of a West Indies cricket team that was winning. You know, I really felt so. So that for me is my crowning achievement. It's a book that's still being written. We haven't gotten to the end yet.
Right.
But where we are thus far is just phenomenal and unbelievable, and no one would have thought it possible. And now I think
you know, I too share that same sentiment. I think if you had asked any career banker 15 years ago if a group of indigenous banks relatively small. I mean, you know, the largest one being, you know, I think that's in the ECC, who didn't participate. The second largest one didn't participate. You know, Bank of St. Lucia didn't participate. So, you know, it's back in the middle. And then, you know, there was Bank of Montserrat, who you brought along as your little brother. You know, say, come on, we're going to the movies. You know, you could come, but you could sit in the back, and, you know, or actually you sit up front because, you know, you don't want to see what we're doing. We don't want to see what you're doing back here. But I thought we were able to accomplish something that no one would have anticipated that a group such as ours would have been able to do. And the other thing I would say is that, you know, I'm a little bit older than you. I was a part of the founding of Bank of Montserrat.
Okay.
You know, and I remember myself and the first chairman sitting around his kitchen table in Boston working on the prospectus. And, you know, I worked on all the financial projections. And we had that vision, or we had a vision back then, because we wanted to call the bank Bank of the Caribbean Montserrat Limited.
I get you.
But because we anticipated at some point down the road, you know, that we were going to grow, and we'll have a Bank of the Caribbean St. Lucia Limited, and and stuff like that. But, you know, we scaled it back, even though we had the vision, because we didn't see, we were like the gazelles, and because a gazelle can jump 10 feet high and 30 feet forward, but you can keep them in a fenced in area with a fence 3 feet tall. Mm-hmm. The reason is they will not jump where they can't see they're going to land. And so that was us. You know, we didn't see where we were going to land. And so we were like, no, let's not give us that aspirational name of, you know. But I think ultimately, and I have spoken to the chairman, the ex-chairman a number of times since we've been going through this process, and he just can't believe it. He literally cannot believe it. He just literally, because it was his idea. It was his baby. It was, you know, and he just cannot believe that he's lived to see where the smaller banks in the region got together and bought out the big bank from Canada. It's just not something that he processes, that he could still process to this day. And I think I agree with you that it is an example for the governments. That's what I would say.
Yeah, I believe so. And that takes me into your second part of the question, where you asked what I believe the greatest impact on people is.
Right.
And I would link it back to this example that we just spoke about. Mm-hmm. Say that at some level, I think I get people to dream bigger than they ever thought they could. I get them to believe that they are bigger, better than they even thought they could be. And I think that sometimes when it works well, great things happen. And sometimes people don't respond too well to it, and sometimes they crack under the expectation. But I believe that as a good leader, you should get people to aspire to be better than even they dreamt they could be. And I think that's what came out of this transaction, and what I expect to see coming out in my teams as we move forward.
So, you know, obviously we can't have this conversation unless we talk about what the last year has been like. You know, I think that, you know, over the last 15 months, I think clearly COVID has been, you know, if not the daily top of the news item, it's in the first block, as we like to say. And so the question then that I'd like to ask is, what has that taught you? You know, what have you learned from having to run a financial organization during COVID to, you know, to go through an acquisition, a major, you know, a once in a lifetime type of acquisition during COVID, you know, when obviously, I don't know if you've been to St. Vincent yet to see what you've bought.
No.
And to touch it and hit the tires. And so, you know, I think that, you know, it would be interesting to get your perspective on, you know, how you, what you've learned, and what, if anything, how that may have changed your methods of operations within the, your banks that you run.
Boy, COVID, I never want to forget 2020. 2020 was the worst and the best year of my career all rolled into one. One of the key things I learned is that the human body can really function well on 3 to 4 hours of sleep. It honestly can. And I now understand how some of those CEOs say they don't sleep, because running an acquisition during COVID at a time when the planes stop flying, the cruise ships stop coming in, all your customers are being laid off or their businesses are closed, your country has gone into lockdown, and you're trying to keep your staff employed. Mm-hmm. You're just going to lose sleep. And it comes back to what I said earlier. The quality of people you have around you is what carries you through these trying times. And I think we were built for COVID. We just didn't know that we were scaling for COVID. So most of the leaders just rolled up their sleeves. And I think we were able to put out a quality moratorium and communication and education process for our clients. Really proud of how we stood by them through this crisis and continue to stand by them. We're now introducing that same support system to the RBC clients who we just onboarded. I'm also proud to say that I don't think we laid off a single worker during this 2019, and we have not asked any of our employees to take any cuts to help the business. So that has been good for us. As a leader, it just says to you, look out for people during their most trying times, and they'll remember you and remember what you have done. And they will reward you and your company for sticking with them when they were at their lowest. And we try to do that, because our founding principle was St. Lucians looking out for St. Lucians, taking care of the average man. And 84 years later, along comes this crisis to test, are you going to really be here for your clients? And from the board to the management to the associates, I think we've demonstrated that we have been. And I'll never want to forget 2020, because it's a big part of who we are. As a bank, we grew in COVID. Our assets grew at a faster rate than we could even imagine. Because again, people felt, I need to show my support for an entity that is out there showing theirs. Our deposit base grew, I think, I'm doing the annual report preparation now, I think deposits grew by 11%. And it says to me that in the worst financial crisis that many people saw, they felt that wherever their money was, it wasn't as safe as putting it here with us. So money came out of other markets, out of other banks, out of other jurisdictions, and came into First National during a financial crisis. So I think it says a lot that we handled the crisis pretty well. We were out there communicating to the clients. We inspired confidence in them, and we continue to demonstrate that we are truly here for them and their financial partner. But it really tests me.
You said a couple of things that I just want to kind of dig a little deeper in. The first thing you said is that I just want to like follow up with you on is, you said that you were built for COVID, but you didn't realize it. How are you built for COVID? And maybe you can share some of, you know, some insights as to as how the way that you're built allowed you to weather the COVID storm as well as you did.
Right. So a lot of what we were doing, from executive development to restructuring our organization and trying to become more digital, we were doing these as business as usual initiatives that we felt were necessary, but we probably had 2 to 3 years to get it done.
Right.
Mobile banking, internet banking, improving our ATMs, improving our debit card offerings. A lot of those things were done as part of building anew and building a refreshed and revitalized First National.
Mm-hmm.
Along comes COVID, right?
Right.
And banks have to shut down. We locked down, but people need service. And we're like, oh my God, what would have happened if we never did all what we did before? Mm-hmm. Where would we have been today? And it comes back to all these good old student companion sayings and all these things that our grandparents taught us.
Yep.
Make hay while the sun shines. Don't leave for tomorrow what can be done today. So we were scaling up this bank for our own good, and COVID hit, and it turned out that we were ready for it, right? So again, it's just we were built for something that we didn't know was coming, and take advantage of every opportunity to scale up. Don't put it off. Sometimes the investment is significant, but if it makes sense, do it early.
Yeah.
If it makes sense, do it early. So the next wave we'll see a lot more automation coming into the business,
mm-hmm,
to remove some of the need for human intervention, and just introducing more power into the hands of the consumer, so that they can control their banking relationship 24/7 from wherever they are.
Right.
So that's where we're going towards in this post-COVID era.
I find that answer to be quite interesting, because, you know, there's this perception within the region that we have to have cash. You know, literally, not in your bank account, but in your hand, in your pocket. Yeah. You know, and I think what COVID has demonstrated is that the need to physically feel and touch cash is a security blanket of sorts, because you can go to sleep without your security blanket. It just kind of makes you feel better when you have it. And it's the same thing with having the cash in your pocket. Because, you know, I think we've had, you know, the experience that we had here in Montserrat is that we had our ATMs, we had online banking. You know, unfortunately, we didn't have our mobile app yet.
Ah, okay.
But you know, but a lot of things you could have still done through the online banking.
Online banking.
Yeah, you could have still done a lot of things through that portal. But it was like, but how am I going to get cash? I said, cash to do what? Well, we need to go to the supermarkets. Well, just take your debit card and go to the supermarket and pay for it. Well, okay. And so how am I going to pay my utility bills? The same way. So I think, you know, for those banks who had, like you had, who invested in the technology, and I've always admired that about you. I really have. I've always admired the forward thinking nature with regards to technology and being, you know, and using the current technology to improve your whatever organization it is that you're working with. And so that is something that I know that you've done well, and you know, you'll continue to do well for First National dash St. Lucia. First National dash St. Kitts Nevis. I'm sorry, St. Vincent and Grenadines. And then First National dash question mark, because I know there's a question mark. Right? The only thing is, you know, as much as I know that today is Wednesday, I know that there is a question mark. What is going to fill in that question mark? I don't know. But I
something's
know
always brewing. Yeah. Something's always brewing.
So, but you know, but you spoke about not sleeping a lot, not, you know, sleeping for maybe 3 or 4 hours a night during COVID. And then I'm sure that that is probably, you know, at most 2 or 3 more hours a night than you normally get without COVID. And so the question then is, you know, given all of that and given all the pressures in the banking industry, how do you relax and who or what keeps you grounded? And I think I know at least a part of this answer, but, you know, I'll listen.
Right. So weekends are very important to me. That's the time when I get to disconnect. Mm. And I live on a farmstead, on a homestead, deep in the bush, right? Far away from everyone. So when I get down there on a weekend, I just fully disconnect. The phone service is even so poor down there. My cell phone doesn't ring. So it's really time to unwind, spend it with family, get my hands dirty in the soil. Yes, I do physically plant dashing and yams and plantains and bananas. So that's how I release all the stress and pressures of the job. And I keep saying to people, it's spiritual being connected to the land and the dirt. Mm-hmm. It teaches you so much patience and gives you that belief in a brighter tomorrow, because you plant this seed hoping that it will grow, and you nurture it and you take care of it and you see the output. And it just takes your mind off all the pressure that you faced the week before and recharges you and grounds you to face the week ahead. I wouldn't have been able to survive this long without the support of my wife, my mom, my dad. Thankfully, I have them around still. Mm-hmm. And the people that I go to for advice, for comfort, when I feel the world is caving in on me, I have a safe haven in their arms. And it's always good to have that. And finally, I have been fortunate enough to work with some of the best and brightest in banking during my long career. And we still stay connected today. So I use them as sounding boards and as mentors. So even though they retired from the banking business, they still get that call from me. Hey, let's talk about this. All throughout COVID, I was having conversations with my retired bosses, right? So it's surrounding yourself with a good, solid network of family and business confidants that can give you that encouragement, give you that guidance, and keep you grounded. So yeah, that's what works for me.
I think that's important that you shared that perspective. I knew about the farming, and that's the one thing that I kind of knew. I think it is so interesting. So, like I said, you know, I'm doing this. And I asked another individual, and I'm not going to, you know, those of you who are watching, if you subscribe to this channel and you turn on your notifications, you'll get to see when the other interviews come up, and then you'll know who I was referring to when I say this. So, you know, you got to do a little cross promotion, Johnathan. I learned from you. I had a little teasing. So I was speaking to someone else and doing another interview. And I said, so, you know, you've had all this success. Kind of what are you looking to do for your next big thing, which I'll ask you eventually. And he said to me, man, you know, I would like to get into farming. I would like to, I just want to go out there. I mean, in my mind, I can see myself, you know, and probably X number of acres. I don't remember what he said. And just, you know, being able to generate food in sufficient quantities so that I can have like a constant supply. And I was like, wow, all these bankers wanting to be farmers. And he says, yeah, I think it just goes back to who we are as West Indians and how we were raised. You know, I'm going to have to keep a list of all of the similar traits that everyone I've spoken to have listed when in the interviews, because I think it'll be very interesting at the end to say, well, you know, go ahead.
You know, I think that's an amazing story, and it probably goes back to something I tell students all the time. Don't get caught up with the bad that international bankers have done. Financial crisis, Bernie mm-hmm. Madoff, Alan Stanford. Don't get caught up in that. I know that's what dominates the news cycle, but banking is a very noble profession. Somebody trusts you enough to give you their life savings.
Yep.
You unlend it, you get a small spread, and you make sure that the person's life savings is protected. And farming is an honorable profession as well. So
it is.
Maybe that's why bankers tend to want to go into farming, because in the profession, right? So maybe that's something to correlate the two in the two professions.
Yeah, yeah. I absolutely like that. So you know, you've got your support system, you know, between your family and your colleagues that have been, you know, that have helped you thus far in your career. But you know, internally, and you know, early on, I'm sorry. We spoke about, you know, your guiding principles about, you know, not being the smartest person in the room, and, you know, hiring people that are more talented than you, and allowing them to do what they do. But so that's from an external perspective about who you bring around you to support, and being smart enough to understand what your deficiencies are, mm-hmm. and, you know, and bringing people in to help you mitigate those. But from an internal perspective, where do you get your inspiration? You know, who or what inspires you to go out and do the things that you do?
Man, I don't like getting that question.
Well, too late.
Because my answer is it's not conventional, right? So I draw my inspiration from the day before, you know.
Okay.
I just try hard to be better than I was the day before, the year before. And I know sometimes we set goals, or we look to others and see how we can aspire to be like them. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I do that on a certain level. But at the end of the day, Dalton, I believe in small incremental steps and continuous improvement. And I draw inspiration from yesterday. So I was able to accomplish this particular task or close this deal yesterday. Where did I go wrong? What could I have done differently? Mm-hmm. Just keep going back. So I would say, think of it as an NBA player just going into the gym and just trying to be better every single day. Mm-hmm. His inspiration may not be to be the next Michael Jordan or LeBron James. His inspiration is to be better in game two than he was in game one.
Right.
And I think that for me is powerful, because you draw it from within and you are driven by yourself. But if you were to ask me, who do I look up to? Who do I follow? Who do I see as a mentor that you're not connected to, a role right. model, somebody that you draw from? I would say that Jamie Dimon has been there throughout. Okay, like and for anybody that wants to pay attention to his story, it's a wonderful story of a rise, a fall, and a rise to extreme heights. Jamie mm-hmm. was fired, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He was fired. So to be where he is today, it shows how you can bounce back and have a second life if you work hard at it. Mm-hmm. The next guy that I really look up to, really, really enjoy reading about, really enjoy following stories about, Elon Musk. He's just the biggest dreamer out there right now. But he's not just a dreamer, he's operationalizing and building his dreams, right? So mm-hmm. so we need to follow these guys. And finally, the retailer in me would not let the conversation end without Jeff Bezos, right? Building Amazon from scratch at a time when nobody knew we needed those services. And what stands out for me is that he understands when the company is now too big for him and he's holding it back.
Yeah.
So he knew when it was right to step away.
Yeah.
And I can't wait for him to give us the story around the decision to step down. That's one book I'll be buying for sure. So,
yeah.
So these are the three guys that I turn to. Yeah, it's three guys, no women on the list as yet. But definitely turn to these three guys for some level of inspiration. But on a day-to-day basis, my inspiration is to just be better than I was yesterday.
And so I remember when I met you first and, you know, kind of in talking with you, there was a saying that if it's not yours, I've attributed it to you. So you should take it. So,
okay. Let's hear this one.
Because I always, I'm almost certain it's yours. It's something that you say with regards to what you try to do in your bank and, you know, is to go from good to great.
That is
something that you say tirelessly.
All the time.
From good to great. And I think what you've just outlined.
It's incremental.
What motivates you to get, how you go about getting from good to great.
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah. Yeah. So, but no, I think those three examples are three good examples. You lost me on Elon because Elon is kind of
way out there.
He's just he's a little too quirky for my taste. He's just a little. No, I wouldn't agree. He is, I think, this generation's embodiment of Steve Jobs.
He's the closest.
Nobody thought that anyone could make an electric car that would run like the Tesla does.
The Tesla, yeah.
Nobody,
It's amazing.
It's just amazing, you know. Take you up to the International Space Station and back down, you know. Nobody, you know. I admire his ability to dream big and to operationalize it. But some of the noise around that is just, you know, it's just, I just can't deal with the noise that's around that. So we have a few more questions. You spoke about obviously COVID and you speak about now the challenge of RBC and the acquisition and the integration thereof. And so when you're faced with challenges in general, what is your go-to strategy or approach to try to deal with those challenges?
Hey, it's like I said earlier, Dalton, and it comes down to three, maybe four things. Well, basically three. So you just got to realize, acknowledge, come to the reality of the fact that you don't have all the answers.
Mm-hmm.
You know? The quicker you can get there, the quicker you'll start overcoming the challenges. Bring your teams into the discussion. You can't solve it alone because you just acknowledge you don't have all the answers, right?
Mm-hmm.
And here's the one that I think we miss out on a lot. Don't be afraid to seek professional help. And I'm not talking about a shrink, right? I'm talking about getting the consultants in the room that have the experience, picking up the phone and calling a fellow colleague from another company or another territory and saying, I'm faced with this problem. Have you ever come across this? How did you deal with it? Go out there and expose your vulnerabilities. Don't be afraid to say that you can't address it, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you will find, and it's something that we, especially as Caribbean people, need to understand a lot more. We have all the answers to solve all the problems that we face in the region if we would just find a way to talk to each other a bit more. And I think for too long, we hid our vulnerabilities.
Yep.
We buried the challenges. to create an image of strength.
Yep.
But my strategy is simple. I don't have all the answers. I'm bringing my teams in the discussion early because one of y'all might have it. And if none of us have it after we do that, oh my God, call a friend.
Yep.
Use that lifeline. Pick up the phone, call a friend, get a consultant in. Mm-hmm. Pick up the phone and call the head of the Bank of Montserrat and find out what the hell did y'all do with a volcano when I'm facing one in St. Vincent, right? So call somebody who dealt with
it and learn from them,
right?
Yeah, yeah. So I did send you that. I did send you that video for you to look at what actually happens to the island when the volcano erupts. Because you know we haven't gone through it. I think I shared something like that with you. You know, but you speak about your back. You know, you speak about at your core, just based on this conversation, at your core, you are a salesperson.
That's what I believe. Yeah.
Yeah, no, and that's what I know. I know that. I see that. You know, having worked in corporate for a long portion of my life, I could spot a good salesperson a mile away. There's something about them, and that eternal optimism that they can get the deal done, they can close it, they can move on to the
next deal. No matter what, yeah.
You know, and so I see that in you. I see that drive in you. I see that vision in you. But the question that I think some may ask of a salesperson who is charged with the fiduciary responsibilities of other people's money, how do you go about ensuring that your innate zeal to always be going and trying to do better and closing the next deal and moving on to be bigger and better, and at the same time being mindful of the fact that, you know, the profession that we're both in is a noble profession because people trust us with their life savings. And so how do you go about balancing that?
Strong board, stronger CFO. And I think when you recognize certain qualities about yourself, you put systems in place and you empower people to keep you honest, right?
Yep.
So I have never overridden a decision from my credit assessment department. I have never overridden a decision from my CFO. I will fight them tooth and nail, but during these discussions, there is no MD in the room.
Right.
We are all three professionals, right? So we have set that boundary. We have that level of trust where we call it as it is. And I am not afraid to lose, but I'll go down fighting, right? And I've lost a few battles. Mm-hmm. And it has worked out in our favor sometimes and worked out to our disadvantage. But you got to respect the systems that you put in place to ensure that there's proper governance and proper structures and procedures to guide the decision-making process. But I think once you have a good board that you respect and that's open to challenge you and you challenge them back, the right decisions can be made at that level. And at the operational level, it comes back to, again, surrounding yourself with good people who are subject matter experts in their field, who you trust, who trust you, and who feel confident in just saying, boss, this one is not a good decision. Leave it alone. And because of that trust that you have in their expertise, you're like, okay, she's seeing something I ain't. So I'm backing down. I'm listening to you on this one.
Right.
So you have to be honest with yourself and put these measures in place to, again, protect you from yourself sometimes.
I understand that. And before I go on to what is the final question that I typically ask everyone, I have to ask another one of, you know, the ones that, you know, this question based on me knowing you. You were the leader of the consortium of banks that, you know, we went out and we got Royal Bank to agree to sell. As you, you know, and I'm asking this question to provide some insight, you know, and so to provide some insight to some other young people coming up who may, you know, be thinking about, I don't know, the next big thing that they want to do. When you thought of it, did you envision that at the end of it all, Royal Bank would not be a player in all of the Eastern Caribbean? Or was this kind of like your own play to gain size in your market so that you can be a little bit more competitive with the big dog down the block from you?
So back in December 2017, I started having this idea. I always knew that it needed to be OECS wide because RBC would never carve out their business. Mm-hmm. And at the same time, I thought they might want to saddle us with Barbados, right? Mm-hmm. But I always knew that it needed to be that way or they would not entertain us. And I just never had the size, scale, or competence to take over everything. So I parked it on a shelf for a few more months. And it's through traveling with CAB and attending conferences. And that's the shameless plug for the Caribbean Association of Banks right here. If you don't go to conferences, you could miss out on key opportunities to grow your business. But anyway, it was at those conferences that I started developing personal relationships with my fellow MDs. And mm-hmm. you get that confidence to just talk about anything. And it was at the CEO conference, I think it was June or July of 2018. We were in the back of a room, crowded around one of those cocktail tables. Mm-hmm. It was myself, Ellensworth Edward from National Bank of Dominica. Mm-hmm. Peter Ash was holding on at Antigua Commercial Bank at the time. Mm-hmm. Everett Martin, Bank of Nevis. And I just threw it out there. Like, what if we had a chance to buy RBC in the OECS and each of you got to keep your own bank building and merge it with your own? And the initial reaction was, do you think they will sell? And I'm like, what do you mean, do I think they'll sell? I don't know, but let's go ask them. The most they can do is say no, right? So we did that. We said we were going to do it, but the first thing we did was jump on the phone to persons who weren't at the conference and really tried to convince others to come on board. I think the most disappointing thing for me coming out of it is that we weren't able to convince every single island to be a part of it. But it gave us and ACB an opportunity to be the first indigenous banks in the OECS to jump outside of the jurisdiction of our birth. Mm-hmm. It's going to be a challenge, but it's a new chapter. And hopefully this is just the start for us all. And I'm saying this to encourage persons watching this broadcast, whether you are a banker or whether you're trying to get into the industry, visit the CAB website, look at what we do as an association and try to come to one of our conferences, whether you are a vendor, supplier, consultant, because a lot of good ideas come out of these conferences, whether it's at a water cooler, a cocktail stand, or a rum and coconut water stop. Good ideas are born at CAB, and we need help fleshing out these ideas, and you can be a part of it too. So come to the conferences. This RBC acquisition was born on a back cocktail table in the back of a room at the CEO conference, June 2018. That's where it was born.
There you go. And now in 2021, 3 years later, we're now in the process, in the throes of the integration, you know, of their banking operations. And so the final question, and I think that's a, before I get to the final question, I think that's a really good plug for what we do, because I think that there are some people who would watch this and they would think, oh, I don't need to go to that. That's above me and, you know, that's beneath me, whatever. But I think you just never know the opportunity that you missed because you weren't there. You know, the opportunity cost, as we like to say it, because you
weren't there.
Yeah, you know, there's opportunity cost for not going. Forget about the cost of going. Yes, it's going to cost you a few dollars, but the opportunity, like we are now enjoying, to grow our business, you know, in ways that we did not even envision 5 or 7 years ago. I think you know came out of coming to the CAB conference, and there'll be others like that. And I think that some of the things that we're working on within the organization for the betterment of the whole banking industry across the region, you know, things like the RTGS and you know and things like that are a testament also to the broad vision that we have of providing solutions, you know, to help the banking sector. Indeed. And the financial sector across the region. So, and then finally, you know, you're a young chap, you know, the runway is long, you know, you're sitting here and you're thinking, I ain't even begin to like, I'm not even up to full taxi speed yet, much less take it off, you know, so take it off into the sunset. You're just kind of rolling down the runway, you know, kind of, yeah. But you've achieved a lot of success at a young age, you know, and besides the integration of the Royal Bank of Canada into your existing operation and making 1 plus 1 equal 12, you know, have you given any thoughts to like your next big undertaking?
Yeah, all the time, especially of late. Of late, I've been saying to my teams, you should not be afraid to understand when something has gotten too big for you. And what got you here isn't necessarily what's going to get you there. And that's just my way of preparing them for the fact that they might need somebody better than me to take them to the next level. I recognize that my time may have been to get us to this point, and somebody else may have to take us further. So of late, I've been doing a lot of introspection on my career and where I want to go next, what I want to do next. I love what I do. I would say my option one is to continue to nurture this newborn that we have created. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, there are a lot of opportunities that become available, whether it is to help another smaller bank achieve something like what we have achieved at First National, whether it be as far as Belize to the north or Guyana to the south, or even in Suriname. But the Caribbean has a lot of opportunities, and I'm open to these opportunities. But again, my first choice would be to try to nurture what we have just created, but always cognizant of the fact that at some point in time, you need to know when somebody better needs to take the reins to guide what you have created to even higher heights. So my next big project, try my best to grow this bank. And if there's another entity out there that is looking for a catalyst for growth, or someone to lead an acquisition or an integration, these opportunities do excite me, and I'd be open to taking a look at it. Yeah.
Okay.
That's
well, you didn't disappoint with that answer, because I always knew there was that question mark up there. You know, there's a question mark. And so you didn't disappoint with that answer. So, you know, and so I think it was a genuine answer.
As genuine as it could be.
You know, and I appreciate that. And again, I would say I appreciate your time today, because I know that you're a busy person. And, you know, and I appreciate your time as you serve on the CAB board, because, again, I think that is for the benefit of all of the financial institutions throughout the region. And, you know, to have someone with your vision, your talent, your experience, and your passion for what you do is a true, true addition and strength, and and blessing to the organization, so to speak. So once again, thank you for your time today. And thank you for the event to the Caribbean Association of Banks. And I hope that, you know, if you like this this broadcast, you know, subscribe and turn on the bell. Subscribe. Oops, there's it. Subscribe. It might be a week. It might be a week. Subscribe.
That's right.
So. All right, Johnathan.
All right. Thank you, Dalton. It was great catching up. Have a good one.
You too.
Thanks to everyone who viewed. Take care.
Thanks. Bye-bye.